So my title today is to discuss immunotherapy evolution for advanced non-small cell lung cancer from an international perspective. This is my conflict of interest declaration. I am a medical oncologist and the director of the 4th Oncology Department and Clinical Trials Unit at the Henri Dunant Hospital Center in Athens, Greece. And the current presentation is kindly sponsored by Bristol Myers Squibb, but this does not affect by any means the content of this presentation. So, as you all know, today our treatment options in first-line treatment of advanced non-small cell lung cancer include chemotherapy, immunotherapy, combinations of chemotherapy and immunotherapy, and lately combinations of immunotherapy. And of course, the big question that we are going to walk through together is how do we choose the appropriate treatment for each patient? So this is a very nice slide that illustrates in a beautiful way the current landscape of clinical trials in advanced non-small cell lung cancer. And let me walk you through this slide. You can see that in the upper half of the sphere, you have the clinical trials incorporating chemotherapy, so chemo-based regimens, while in the lower half of this sphere, you have regimens that are chemo-sparing, so regimens that try to put away chemotherapy from the first-line treatment of lung cancer. And on the left half, you can see trials in patients with squamous non-small cell lung cancer, and on the right half of the slide, trials in patients with non-squamous. And you can also see that some of the trials have also included potential biomarkers of efficacy of immunotherapy, including PD-L1. You have some trials in patients with PD-L1 high expression, and also the presence of oncogene addiction like EGFR or ALK alterations, and finally, the tumor mutational burden. So starting from this slide, let's try to see the main clinical trials and their results. We should also remember that in these trials, we are being assisted in our effort to select the optimal chemotherapy regimen for each patient by biomarkers, which include PD-L1 expression, mutational burden, and some more sophisticated techniques like immune profile gene signatures and tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes. So, first of all, let's see the applications of immunotherapy in first-line treatment. Do we have any patients that can benefit from immunotherapy only? We now know from the first clinical trial that was conducted, KEYNOTE-024, which is now 5 years old, and we have mature survival outcomes, that in patients whose tumors express PD-L1 in more than 50% of tumor cells, we have a clear survival benefit in patients starting with first-line pembrolizumab instead of chemotherapy. And you can see that in 2 years follow-up, practically more than 0.5% of patients are alive in the pembrolizumab arm as compared to the chemotherapy arm. And the median overall survival is 30 months, which is really something because these patients are patients with advanced disease and bear a dismal prognosis. We have a second agent that is approved in the same setting for patients with high expression of PD-L1, and this is the anti-PD-L1 monoclonal antibody atezolizumab. You can see here the registrational trial. Atezolizumab showed a meaningful and important survival benefit only in the patient population with more than 50% expression of PD-L1 in tumor cells. And very recently, we had a third agent in this approval, cemiplimab, another anti-PD-L1 monoclonal antibody with a clear survival benefit in the high expression population. There is another property of cemiplimab. This is the only trial that also included patients with locally advanced disease. So if we have patients with locally advanced inoperable disease and then high PD-L1 expression, and these patients are not candidates for radical chemoradiotherapy, we can offer cemiplimab to these patients. So what about combinations of chemotherapy with immunotherapy? Can we improve outcomes? Here, we have also mature data from combinations of chemotherapy with pembrolizumab, the KEYNOTE-189 trial for patients with non-squamous histology. And you can see that here we have a clear survival benefit in all patient sub-cohorts, all patient cohorts independent of the expression of PD-L1. You can see that even in PD-L1 negative patients, there is a clear benefit of chemotherapy. And the same is true also for the sister trial in patients with squamous histology, which was KEYNOTE-407 trial, showing again a consistent survival benefit, 1.5 years for these patients with squamous histology that we know that are difficult patients to treat, and a clear survival benefit, again, independent of PD-L1 expression. Taken all together, these trials, if we see the KEYNOTE and IMpower trials of atezolizumab, you can see that both in patients with non-squamous histology and in patients with squamous histology, there is a clear survival benefit with the addition, the combination of chemotherapy plus immunotherapy for both disease progression and death. So can we do even better if we add anti-angiogenic treatment in this chemo-immunotherapy combination? Well, I'm sure that you are all aware of the IMpower150 trial, a large randomized phase 3 trial that evaluated the incorporation of bevacizumab, the anti-VEGF monoclonal antibody, into the chemotherapy backbone, and it was compared with or without atezolizumab. So there were two experimental arms in this trial. In arm A, we had the combination of chemotherapy with atezolizumab, the anti-PD-L1 monoclonal antibody. And in B, we had the quadruplet regimen, which was the combination of chemotherapy, bevacizumab, and atezolizumab. And what we can see is also that this trial also included patients with oncogene, was one of the few trials that included patients with oncogene-addicted tumors. And you can see here clearly that there is a clear overall survival benefit in the whole patient population, which was patients with non-squamous histology because of the use of bevacizumab, and a clear survival benefit of approximately 5 months. And if we go at the comparison of arm A versus arm C, meaning the chemo plus atezo versus the chemo plus bevacizumab arm, we can see here that the combination, that the benefit is less prominent and the survival benefit is not statistically significant. And this suggests that the combination of anti-angiogenesis with chemotherapy confers another benefit. Here in this trial, we also see the same pattern that when we have combinations of chemotherapy with immunotherapy, PD-L1 loses its predictive capacity. So you can see that the quadruplet combination was associated with improved survival independent of the PD-L1 expression. There is another important sign in IMpower150. We saw that there were two subgroups of patients. The first subgroup was patients with liver metastasis, But of course, as we know, this is a heterogeneous group of patients. And secondly, patients with oncogene-addicted tumors that seem to derive the largest clinical benefit from the quadruplet regimen. And of course, this is not a regimen for everybody. In the final analysis of this trial, these hazard ratios were not as striking as here. The hazard ratio for liver metastasis was 0.68. But taken all together, these trials, I describe them all together here to you for the sake of time, you can see two basic conclusions. The first conclusion is that when you have combinations of chemotherapy with immunotherapy, PD-L1 loses its predictive capacity, whereas in IO monotherapy, we have the predictive value of PD-L1. And the second important conclusion is that as you see on the right of your picture, of your slide, you have the rate of crossover for each trial. And what you can see is that even in trials with a high crossover rate, such as IMPARON 130, the survival benefit of chemoimmunotherapy in first line still remains statistically significant, despite the fact that many of the patients in the control arm were able to receive immunotherapy in the second line. So the basic conclusion here is that immunotherapy should be administered together with chemotherapy in first line and not as a salvage regimen in second line. And let's go to the final part of the presentation, which is immunotherapy combinations. And this is, of course, the dream of a chemo-free first-line regimen in non-small cell lung cancer. Is this feasible? Well, the theory is there. We have a biological rationale telling us that there is a potential synergistic effect when we combine immune checkpoint inhibition between PD-1 and CTLA-4, which are both important checkpoint inhibitors. And this because PD-1 interactions are being done within the tumor microenvironment, whereas the CTLA-4 blockade happens in all the lymphatic system, everywhere where there are lymph nodes in the body, where there is the interaction between the antigen-presenting cell and the T lymphocyte. So the mechanism of difference is quite different, and the combination could have a potential synergistic approach and not just an additive effect. So this was the CheckMate 227 trial, a very well-known trial, mature now, that tried to evaluate the combination of nivolumab plus ipilimumab, so an anti-PD-1 and an anti-PD-L1 agent in patients with advanced non-small cell lung cancer. And PD-L1 expression was an important stratification factor, so patients with PD-L1 positive disease were randomized to either doublet IO or chemotherapy or just nivolumab, whereas, as you can see in the design, for patients with negative PD-L1 expression, so PD-L1 negative tumors, the randomizations included IO combination, chemotherapy, and chemo IO in an effort to compensate for the lack of PD-L1 expression. And the primary endpoint of the trial was, first of all, there were two co-primary endpoints, disease-free survival, progression-free survival, depending on tumor mutational burden. This was a trial that also incorporated tumor mutational burden and overall survival depending on PD-L1 expression. So as you all know, this tablet combination showed a clinically meaningful improvement in overall survival, even while we had a higher crossover rate, you can see of 43%, but still you can see in the red square at the beginning of the curves that the curves diverged. That means converge. That means that we have some patients that unfortunately lose their lives in their first 6 months of treatments without being able to ever receive chemotherapy. And that means that with the doublet IO combination alone, we lose some patients that are not amenable to these treatments. And you can see that in responders, there is a high sign of efficacy for the Nivo plus Ipi combination. You can see, for example, here that patients who respond in nivolumab plus imilibumab combination, the duration in responders lasts for up to 2 years, which is something really important. But unfortunately, not all patients derive the equal benefit. There was another surprise in the results of CheckMate 227. You can see that patients with PD-L1 negative expression also benefit from the Nivo plus Ipi combination. And these patients also have an important clinical benefit, but this was not the ITP population. So if we try to dissect the patient population to see who are the patients that benefit the most from the doublet IO combinations and who are the patients who benefit the less, you can see that there is a clinical and statistically meaningful benefit in PD-L1 negative and high PD-L1 patients, but you can see that in patients with intermediate PD-L1 expression, 1 to 49% survival is absolutely identical. That means that this subgroup of patients is the one that does not have important clinical benefit from doublet IO as compared to chemotherapy. And finally, tumor mutational burden that was also evaluated in this trial was not a robust predictive factor for IO efficacy. On the other hand, it was a positive, a favorable prognostic biomarker because, as you can see, both the group of patients that received doublet IO and the group of patients that received chemotherapy had substantially better outcomes as compared to other patients, independent of PD-L1 expression. So how can we correct this lack of efficacy in the 1 to 49% subgroup? This is exactly the rationale of the CheckMate 9LA regimen, which was an improved CheckMate 227 regimen. And of course, the basic idea in this trial, the basic hypothesis was that adding a limited course of chemotherapy to the Nivo plus Ipi combination could potentially provide rapid disease control, so we don't lose these patients in the first 6 months of treatments, while on the other hand, we can exploit therapeutically the durable overall survival benefit that we saw in CheckMate 227 with the Nivo plus Ipi combination. So this was the rationale of the clinical trial, 2 cycles of chemotherapy. And after that randomization in the experimental arm with the Nivo plus Ipi combination, you can see here in the design of the trial that PD-L1 expression was a stratification factor. And secondly, you can see that the Ipi regimen was the low Ipi dosing, so 1 milligram per kilogram of body weight every 6 weeks, so the mini EP regimen, as we used to call it, and this combination was continued for a maximum of 2 years for immunotherapy as a maintenance treatment. So this regimen may sound a little bit complex, but it's not in a clinical practice. Practically, the patients receive the 4 drugs only in the first cycle of treatment. They come again after 3 weeks, second cycle of chemotherapy and nivolumab, and thereafter they come every 3 weeks for the Nivo plus Ipi and every other 3 weeks for just the Nivo treatment, and this continues for a maximum of 2 years. You can see from this trial that this was a typical patient population with advanced non-small cell lung cancer. So we had approximately 40% of patients which were PD-L1 negative and CNS disease in 18% of patients. And these were the first overall survival presented at the first interim analysis, you can already see a very strong sign of survival benefit from the chemo plus nivo plus ipi combination. And most importantly, the curves do not converge. That means that we do not lose patients in the first 6 months of treatment. And at the updated follow-up of these patients, after a follow-up of 13 months, this benefit persists and is even higher. So you can see a total median overall survival of 15.6 months for the experimental arm. And please be reminded that this trial includes both patients with non-squamous and squamous histology. And we all know that squamous histology has a worse prognosis. What is even more interesting is that if we split by histology, we can see that there is a benefit independent of the histological subtype. And moreover, there is a strong sign of efficacy in patients with squamous cell histology, which we know hazard ratio there is 0.62. So a 38% reduction in the risk of death. And this is something really important for this subgroup of patients. And again, the same pattern when we have combinations of chemotherapy with IO, PD-L1 does not have a predictive capacity, the same level of benefit independent of PD-L1 expression, even in patients with PD-L1 high expression. So to conclude, this is my last slide. Instead of a conclusion slide, I tried to provide you an algorithm taken by a nice recent review for the current treatment algorithm. So you can see that the two basic stratification factors are histological subtype and the PD-L1 expression. On the left column, you can see that in PD-L1 negative population, we have the combinations of chemo IO, of course, the quadruplet combination, and recently the chemo plus doublet IO combination. In the intermediate expression group, between 1 to 49%, the choices are again the same. But in the high PD-L1 expression subgroup, which is the right column, we have the choice of mono immunotherapy with either pembrolizumab, atezolizumab, or cemiplimab. And again, we have the choices of quadruplet regimen and the chemo plus doublet IO regimen, which are highly efficacious. And of course, the question still remains of the optimal selection of treatment for each patient. And I would like to stop here with my last words, which would be that the treatment decision should always be individualized for each unique patient. Each tumor is unique for each patient. We should take into account factors like the general performance status, the presence of comorbidities, contraindications for chemotherapy, contraindications for immunotherapy or anti-angiogenic treatment, the possibility of toxicities, practical issues like the distance of the patient's residence to the oncology center, and of course, always discussing the preference of the patient to enable us to choose the optimal treatment regimen. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I am here for any comments or questions you might have.